Hey everyone, it's Carissa Wiley here for EllenHudson.com. Thanks for joining me today. Today we are talking all about inks. There is so much information in this video and there are so many different types of inks out on the market. I'm hoping that this brings a little clarity to the different types of inks that are on the market, and I'm going to show you some of my favorite kind of specialty inks. So here's a look at several different types of inks, and I have dye inks, I have pigment inks, I have hybrid inks, and I have what I consider to be some basics and specialties in here as well. Now, like I said, there's a lot of different types of ink on the market, and sometimes it can be a little tricky figuring out what you need. So we're gonna start with dye inks, and then we're gonna move into pigment inks, and then hybrid inks as well. And those are the three kind of main types of inks that are on the market. And then we'll talk about some specialty and some basics as well. Now, in addition to talking about the different types of ink in this video, I'm also going to talk about ink blending, what inks are best for which types of techniques, and we're going to go over how to refresh your ink pad as well. So there's lots of information. Let's dive right in. Now, the first type of ink I'm going to talk about are dye inks, and that is because they are the most common on the market. They're available from a wide range of manufacturers in a huge range of colors, and they all kind of have a little bit something unique about them from manufacturer to manufacturer. So in order to kind of provide clarity on the subject of dye inks, I'm gonna make some generalizations. Now, generally speaking, dye inks are gonna be very transparent. You're gonna see right through this stamp, even though it's inked up, to my fingers behind the block. And dye inks, when they're stamped onto the paper, are going to soak into the fibers of the paper and dye the paper. Now, this gives you a couple of different qualities that may or may not be desirable depending on what you're doing. Number one, they're fast drying, so you're not gonna smudge these types of inks. The other thing is that when you stamp a dye ink, for the most part, they're going to do what we call dry back. So the color that you stamp originally may not be the color that that ink stays. It kind of dries back a little bit as it soaks into the paper. And that's not necessarily a bad thing. Just keep that in mind. You want to let your swatches and your inks dry before you get a true color. Now, a common misconception about dye inks is that they are all water reactive because they're all made with dyes, and this is simply not true. I'm gonna show you that with these Catherine Pooler and Hero Arts inks. I've stamped them onto some Nina Solar White cardstock and I've allowed them to dry. I've even heat set them with a heat tool. Now I'm coming in with a water brush and I'm exposing these inks to water, and you're gonna see that the Catherine Pooler inks are gonna start reacting and moving with water right away. The Hero Arts inks are gonna stay put. Now, this is not necessarily a good or a bad thing. It's depending on the types of techniques that you're doing. If you're going to put some glossy accents over an ink, you may want to choose an ink that's not water reactive, because when you add the glossy accents, it's going to add some moisture to it and cause that ink to kind of bleed. The same thing with stickles. But if you want to be able to watercolor with your inks or something like that, you may want to choose a water reactive ink. Now, dye inks are going to be good for things like basic stamping, but they're not going to be great for embossing or things like that because they are fast drying. Now, let's talk about the next type of ink, and we're going to talk about pigment inks. Now, pigment inks are available from a wide range of manufacturers in a wide range of colors, but they are slower drying than dye inks, and they tend to be opaque. And that means that the color that you see on the pigment ink pad is generally the color that you're going to get when you stamp it on the paper. So you can see the colors of these two pigment ink pads here. You can kind of see the ink on the pad. But when I bring in this dye ink pad, which was the lightest pink that I stamped before, it looks fairly dark on the pad. Now, pigment inks are going to be opaque, as I mentioned. So you can see when I put it on the stamp, it's more paint-like. You cannot see through to my fingers like you could with the dye ink. Pigment inks are going to sit on top of the paper and dry kind of like a layer of paint on top of the paper. Now, they're not going to flake off like paint would do on paper, but that kind of gives you a general idea of how pigment inks work versus dye inks. Now, that opacity makes them easier to stamp on other colors of cardstocks and get you more pigment payoff than a dye ink would. Dye inks aren't really great for stamping on colored or dark cardstocks unless you're doing a tone-on-tone effect. Now, pigment inks don't have that dry back. It's like once you stamp it, that's the color that you're going to get. And they are much slower drying than a dye ink, which makes them great for things like ink blending and embossing. And I'm just going to show you that quickly here. I've stamped this heart onto some Nina Solar White cardstock in some pigment ink, and then I'm adding some clear embossing powder over the top and heat setting it. And that gives me a pink, raised, glossy image. So pigment inks are great for colored embossing using just clear embossing powder as well. Now let's look at the pigment and the dye ink side by side. First, I stamp the dye ink dry to the touch immediately. Pigment ink, on the other hand, is going to be more prone to smudging, and it's hard to see on this, but this pigment ink has quite a bit of smudge around it, whereas the dye ink, since it's dry to the touch immediately, doesn't really smudge if you run your hand across it. Now, due to the opacity of pigment ink, if you stamp it over a stamped line, there is a chance that that pigment ink is going to kind of occlude your black stamped line. Now, it's kind of hard to see in the video here, but this pigment ink is definitely layering over the top of that black pen that I've placed, whereas the dye ink, since it's more transparent, allows that black to stay truer and richer. Now I'm gonna show you an illustration here that I hate to do. I'm gonna stick my fingers in the different types of ink because I think this really shows you what happens on top of the paper. On my left hand is the dye ink. You can see that it's transparent. On my right hand is the pigment ink. You can see that it's opaque. Now when I go to clean this off, you're going to see that the dye ink has actually soaked into my finger and stained my finger. On the other hand, the pigment ink is gonna wipe right off, and my skin is not stained from the ink. So that kind of gives you an idea of what it's doing in the paper as well. So I'm hoping that gives you a better understanding of dye ink versus pigment ink. Now let's get into hybrid inks. Now hybrid inks are a combination of dye and pigment inks. So some of them have more dye ink-like properties, but they are combined with that pigment ink. And some of them tend towards more pigment inks with some of the dye-based properties. So these have the most range of variants as far as properties are concerned. But basically, they are a true, vibrant, rich ink that tends to dry faster than a pigment ink, but slower than a dye ink. And that's kind of the best way that I can generalize a hybrid ink. It's a combination dye and pigment, but it is faster drying than a pigment ink and slower drying than a dye ink. Now, like I said, there's gonna be a lot of variance in properties in a hybrid ink, and that depends on if it's more dye-like or if it's more pigment-like. They're gonna be dry to the touch almost immediately, but they're gonna stay wet underneath the surface long enough that you can actually emboss with these. Depending on the ink, the manufacturer of the ink, they can be more opaque or more transparent. But these colors tend to stamp in their true color, and they don't have that kind of dry back that you get with a dye-based ink. Now I'm gonna just show you quickly that although these are dry to the touch, as you saw me swipe my hand across them earlier, they do stay wet underneath the surface long enough that you can actually heat emboss with these. And I've done it with all three of the hybrid inks that I'm showing today. And so that makes them really versatile as well. Now these inks are great for stamping, but what I see most people using hybrid inks for are ink blending, because the fact that they stay wet a little bit longer makes them a little more blendable. Now, speaking of ink blending, let's get into it. I believe you can blend with any kind of ink, but the problem is you have to find the right ink, tool, and paper combination. It really does make a difference. And so I'm gonna go through kind of some basics of ink blending, starting with the tools. And I'm gonna group them into two categories. The first category is a foam blending tool. And I have one from Ranger and one from Tonic Studios here. They have a foam pad that's removable. And these are very, very similar. It just kind of depends on which grip you prefer a little bit more. They're gonna give you kind of similar results. Another type of foam ink blending tool is a ink dauber that you can put on your finger. This gives you a little more precise blending. And then finally, a sponge, a blending sponge. And I love these here from Tonic as well. Now, for the most part, your foam blending tools are going to give you a greater density of ink. Now, the next type of blending tool are blending brushes. And I have some here from Clarity Stamps. These are a blending brush. They're a synthetic brush. And you just pick it up and pick up the ink with the brush and swipe it across the paper. And then the other type of brush that I have is this blending brush here. They're available in a variety of sizes. These are from Picket Fence Studios. And the fineness of the bristles in both of these types of brushes and the fact that they spread out when you blend with them gives you a much softer blend. So I'm going to show you this side by side, all of these different types of inks on two different types of paper. Now let's talk about paper here. Bristol Smooth is a coated paper. You are going to notice that your ink glides across that paper. Nina doesn't have any sort of coating on it, but you can still blend on Nina Solar White cardstock. It's kind of like I said before, you have to have the right combination of ink, tool, and paper to get the best results. Now, as I mentioned, you can blend with any type of ink, but your results are going to vary. So you're gonna see me blend first with the foam applicator tool. And you're gonna notice that on the Nina Solar White cardstock and on the Bristol cardstock that I get a much more dense concentration of ink. So if you want to fully cover a piece of cardstock, then you may wanna start with a foam ink blending tool. Now the brush, on the other hand, is going to work on both cardstocks, but it's going to give me a much softer blend, which means if I want really dense ink, I'm going to have to work longer and harder to get that ink built up. Now overall, you're going to notice that all of the blending is going to be a little bit smoother with less work on that Bristol Smooth because it's a coated paper and it glides across. But as I mentioned before, you can ink blend with any of these types of inks, but your results are going to vary based on the paper that you're using and the type of tool that you're using. So I just kind of wanted to show you this side by side and show you the foams are on the left, the brushes on the right, and the same inks all the way down on both pieces of paper. Now to clean these brushes, I like to just swipe them across a baby wipe. And if they need a deeper cleaning, you can definitely clean them with some warm soapy water in the sink. Now just quickly wanted to show you the blending brush here from Clarity as well. Once again, a very soft, smooth blend, even on the Nina Solar White cardstock, and a much less density of ink. So it's gonna take longer to build up. Now, next up are solvent inks, and solvent inks are great for stamping on slick surfaces, and I'm using the Stazon inks today. They're available in a variety of colors, but I just have the black and the white, and I wanted to show you, you're not going to get a dye ink to dry on a piece of acetate, but these Stazon inks will definitely dry on acetate, allowing you to stamp sentiments on your shaker windows and create really cool effects. The bad part about these is they're a little more difficult to clean off of your stamp. So you are gonna need like a stamp scrubber and some stamp cleaner like the Hero Arts Ultra Clean. Now, I absolutely love the white version of this. It does come with a re-inker because it does need to be re-inked often, but this creates such cool effects on a shaker window. And it's a technique I haven't done in a while that maybe I need to bring back up. Now, next up are a couple of specialty inks that I really love. The Versamark Watermark Ink Pad is great for creating watermark effects. It really shows up well on this craft cardstock, which I'm showing you. And then the Hero Arts Unicorn White Pigment Ink, I also love. It is beautiful on craft cardstock as well, or darker colored cardstocks. You can also layer it with some dye inks to create some really cool effects. And both of these are great for adding embossing powder over the top. Now the Versamark ink, I use that for almost all of my embossing, but you're gonna see that when I add the clear embossing powder over that unicorn white pigment ink, you're gonna get kind of a milky effect. You can see that watermark effect there and the beautiful dry back that you get with that pigment ink. So if you're wanting to do some white heat embossing, I definitely recommend, instead of using the white pigment ink with the clear embossing powder, that you use the Versamark ink and a white embossing powder. And you're going to see the difference of the opacity in that white embossing powder there on the right versus that kind of milky one when using the unicorn white pigment ink. But those are great inks to have on hand. Next up are distress inks, and I put this in the specialty ink category because they are dye inks, but they are very water reactive, and people tend to use these most for techniques. They are not super great for general stamping, in my own personal opinion. And since there are so many videos on distress inks, I decided not to concentrate on them today. Now, next up in the specialty ink category is the Ink On 3 Fade Out ink. Now, this is great for no line coloring. You're gonna see that when I stamp it here, it's gonna give me kind of like a light grayish outline. Then you can do your coloring, and that ink is going to actually pick up the color of the coloring medium that you put over the top. And you're not seeing it here, but over time, this ink is going to fade back even more and leave you with a really cool no line coloring effect. Now, finally, I'm going to talk about my go-to black ink, starting with Gina K Obsidian Black, the Versafine Onyx Black Pigment Ink, and the Versafine Claire Nocturne Ink. These are the ones that I reach for all the time. A few slight variances in them. The Gina K Amalgam Ink is great for sentiments. It's great for Copic coloring. It's dry to the touch immediately. You can use it with Gamsol and colored pencils. You can use it to watercolor. So it is a great, versatile black ink. Now, if I'm just stamping a sentiment, I tend to reach for either the Versafine Onyx Black Pigment Ink, although this is a pigment ink, so it does have a tendency to smudge, so you want to be careful with it because it is a little bit slower drying, just like all pigment inks, or I reach for the Versafine Claire. Now, this is a pigment ink as well, but it's a little faster drying than the Versafine Onyx Black Pigment Ink. All of these are my go-to black inks, and they stay right by me in the desk at all times because I use them all the time. Now, finally, let's go over how to refresh an ink pad. I keep my ink pad re-inkers in this little alcohol ink storage tin from Tim Holtz, and I have grabbed the coordinating re-inker for my ink pad here. I want to show you this ink pad is really dry. It's supposed to be navy blue, and that's what it looks like when it is stamped. So you can see it definitely needs a re-ink. And before I put ink to this pad, I'm going to make sure that the base of my pad, the lid of my pad, and the re-inker are all the same. I'm going to double and triple check it because I don't want to put the wrong ink on the wrong pad. Then you're going to end up with a mess. Now, once I've confirmed I have the right re-inker, I'm going to just drop drops of this ink all across the surface of the pad, and you can see I've kind of spread them out there. Then I'm gonna cover this pad up and I'm gonna let it set. And I'm gonna come back to it and I am going to stamp it again. And you're gonna see that I have a nice, rich, navy blue image the way it was intended because this is properly inked. So I wanted to show you this up close because in the middle image, it's a little bit blotchy. That was mid re-ink. I actually added a few more drops to my pad and then that is the final result there. So if you're finding that your inks are not true to the color they should be, you may need to go ahead and re-ink them. So there you have it, the essential guide to inks. So much information, but I hope this kind of helps you wade through all the choices that are out there when it comes to inks for stamping. As always, I will have links to the featured products used in this video in the description at YouTube, but head on over to the ellenhutson.com blog. Over there, you'll find more still shots, more information, and links to everything. As always, thanks for stopping by and hanging out with me today. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, be sure to give it a thumbs up and don't forget to subscribe and turn on the notifications here on the ellenhutson.com YouTube channel. As always, thanks for watching, and until next time, I hope you have a fabulous day.